We begin this morning with Thursday's fatal shooting in the Auckland CBD. The Corrections Department is reviewing the handling of the man responsible, who was on home detention when he carried out the attack. Since coming to power in 2017, Corrections Minister Kelvin Davis has overseen a deliberate and significant reduction in prisoner numbers in New Zealand. I sat down with the minister and began by asking what specific inquiries he made of his department following Thursday's attack.
First of all, we need to acknowledge the victims. It's a tragic event. It's not something that we ever want to see in New Zealand. So my heart goes out to those people who were the immediate victims, their whānau. In terms of the assurances that I've sought from Corrections, there is a Chief Probation Officer is doing a review or an investigation into what has gone on. I needed to know in the first instance when I heard that something had gone on, whether or not there had been any Corrections involvement with the person. It turns out there has been. But we need to let those investigations run their courses. There's no point making assumptions or presumptions about any part of it. I think we need to leave the professionals to go about their investigation, and then we will respond to the results of those investigations.
Matu Reid beat his girlfriend so seriously that she fractured her neck. He kicked her, slapped her, threw a wine bottle and scissors at her head and strangled her for 10 seconds, which for the victim would have been a terrifying period of time. Is it your expectation that someone convicted of those kinds of crimes can be on home detention?
Well, the first thing is again, acknowledge the experience that his victim went through, and that is horrible, and that is just something that you and I cannot imagine, that level of violence. But we also have to remember that judges make decisions about what happens to offenders. The offender turns up in court, the judge makes the decision. As the Minister of Corrections, we have to live with the judge's decision and make sure that the person's time under corrections care is done correctly.
Right, but I mean, you're part of a government that essentially sets the laws, which decides the kinds of sentences that criminals receive. So is it your expectation that someone who would commit those kinds of crimes could be released on home detention?
Look, again, it's really a matter for the judge who hears all the evidence, who is there through the court process, and the judge makes the decision. And as politicians, we actually have to be very careful about reacting to what judges do. There is a reason why the courts and politicians need to remain separate.
Why did the government introduce a new crime of non-fatal strangulation?
Yeah, because we know that strangulation, and I believe that came in under the previous government, which we would have agreed to, because strangulation is a precursor to further family violence. So it is important that is acknowledged, but again, it is a judge that hears all the evidence and makes decisions as to what needs to happen to the perpetrator.
Non-fatal strangulation is recognised internationally as a high risk factor for future harm, including a much higher risk of killing someone. Why should anyone convicted of that crime be allowed to serve their sentence on home detention rather than in prison?
Look, again, I don't want to preempt the judges' decisions. They make the decisions based on the evidence that they have
in front
of them.
You're saying the government bears no responsibility in the kinds of sentences that people receive?
What I'm saying is that judges hear the evidence. They are there. They make the decisions based on what is put in front of them. Mm. If that person had have gone to prison to serve his sentence, then as a politician, we have to accept that that is the decision.
How many violent offenders are currently on home detention?
Look, I don't have that level of detail here. But again, if there is somebody on home detention, that is because a judge has put them on home detention.
Should violent offenders be on home detention, in your opinion?
Well, without wanting to sound... There are levels of violence, and again, the judges will make their decisions based on the level of violence. My role as the Minister of Corrections is to make sure that any prisoner complies with the conditions of their sentence. Mm.
But in your role as the Minister of Corrections, you have been a staunch advocate in reducing the prison population and increasing the prevalence of electronic monitoring. Is that correct?
Well, in terms of the decrease in the prison population, when we became government, there was a prison population crisis. There were literally about a dozen beds left in the whole system. So we probably only needed one weekend of a number of arrests, and there would have been, we'd have been having to look at triple bunking, people being bunked in hallways. There was even discussions around commissioning closed boarding schools. Now, that was something that I don't think that the community and New Zealand would have accepted. So there had to be something else. The building of more prisons was always going to take a number of years. The prison population from 2015 for the next 3 years grew at an exponential rate, almost a 50% increase. If it had carried on at the same rate, we'd have had over 14,000 people in prison, but at the present time we've only got about 11,500 beds. So there was a crisis in that.
So how much has the use of electronic monitoring increased since Labor came to power in 2017?
Well, it only started towards the end of the last government, so of course there was always going to be a build-up of the number of people who would be electronically monitored.
But as the prison population's come down, electronic monitoring has increased.
So there's electronic monitoring and there's home detention. Now, I'll get them mixed up, but one has gone down significantly since about December of 2017. The other has gone up.
This is part of your response to the what you saw as a crisis in terms of prison numbers. You wanted to see the number of people being monitored at home increase and the number of people in prison come down?
Well, we wanted to look at a range of factors. So, for example...
But that was one, right?
Well, it is one, and it came in before our time. And I don't determine who gets electronic monitoring. I don't determine who gets home detention. But, there's a number of things that Corrections has done. For example, the judge is looking at somebody who might be bailed, but they've met all the criteria except for the fact that they don't have somewhere safe to live. Corrections has gone out and created a whole heap of supported living situations in the community, about 300 beds, so that the judge can make a decision about someone being bailed to a safe place. So there's been a number of things that Corrections has done to support judges to make decisions as to whether or not to bail or not to.
So you've reduced the prison population since you came into power by about 20%. Do you consider that a success?
Look, what's more important to me is the fact that the reconviction rates have gone down, I think, by 11% and the re-imprisonment rates by about 8%. That shows that what we are doing is working.
You said in a speech to the Labor Congress last month, quote, "We have safely reduced the prison population." What evidence do you have that Kiwis are safer as a result of that drop?
Well, there is a reduction in offending. Everybody has to realise that the crime rate is going down. If you look at the spike in youth crime, for example, ram raids, I saw a Herald article saying that ram raids are 0.38% of all offending, and yet it's consuming 100% of our headspace. So we have to look at the overall situation, that overall crime is going down. Violent crime is going up, but we also have to look at...
So violent crime's going up, and you've talked about making Kiwis safer, so I want to understand how reducing the prison population by about 20% has made Kiwis safer.
Yeah, and the people who are committing violent crime are going to prison. So there's been an increase in the numbers of gang members. There's also the demographics in prison has increased. Those people who commit crimes, who commit violent crimes, are going to prison.
Well, they're not, are they? Because Matu Reid beat his former girlfriend so seriously that she fractured her neck.
Yeah. And like I say, the judge has made a decision that is going to be the sentence.
But the point is that violent criminals aren't necessarily going to prison. Between 2017 and 2022, the number of serious assaults reported to police or reported by police increased 121%. Reports of acts intended to cause injury went up by almost 30%. What is the link between a lower prison population and higher rates of violent crime?
The link between a lower prison population and higher rates of violent crime. Well, one of the things that I think we need to look at is, and I've always said, the more people you put in prison, then the more people in the future you're going to have to put in prison. And if we look at the increase in the prison population from 2015 onwards, we incarcerated, or the then government incarcerated people at a greater rate of knots, and we're wondering why there is a greater You know, there are more people committing violent crime now. There is a correlation.
You're the government.
You've been in government. 2015.
Yeah, but you've been in government for 6 years now, and violent crime is up now since 2017. This is the period in which we're seeing the same period in which the prison population has gone down. Violent crime's gone up, and that's on you.
No, and that's what I'm saying. From 2015 onwards, the prison population went up by 3,000 people, and we wonder why there's an impact.
So you're blaming the violent crime now on the previous government that was booted out in 2017.
The more people you incarcerate now, in the future, you will incarcerate more people. So in 2015, there was an increase in the prison population, and that means now we're dealing with the impact of that increase in the prison population as well. It's not just this government and that government. We've got to look at the whole picture over a period of time, and there was a distinct increase in the prison population under the National Act and Māori Party government previously. And now we're also dealing with crime. Nobody's looking into that. Everyone is looking just at, this is happening in this period of time, but you've got to look at the impact of policy decisions in the past as well, because we're having an impact there, also having an impact now.
So as Corrections Minister, do you take any responsibility for the increases in violent crime under your government?
So I don't. As a Minister of Corrections, I have to make sure that the people who are sent to prison, that they get the best treatment, care, so that when they emerge at the end of their sentence, whenever it may be, are best placed.
That hasn't answered the question. Do you take any responsibility for the increase in violent crime?
As the Minister of Corrections, I'm doing my best to make sure that the people that come into the care of corrections emerge as contributing members of society.
A big part of your driving force in reducing the prison population was to reduce the levels of Māori incarceration, which I think everyone agrees is a disgrace. So the overall number of Māori in prison has gone down, but the total percentage of Māori in prison has actually increased relative to other groups. Why is that?
Yeah, that's been one of the difficulties, because everything that we have done in corrections has been aimed at targeting our Māori prison population. And I guess the old saying that what's good for Māori is good for all New Zealanders also holds true, because what we're seeing is that non-Māori are benefiting probably more than Māori, despite the fact that we are really targeting Māori strategies, such as the Māori pathways. Hokuairangi is the corrections strategy. It started off as a Māori strategy. There was no Māori strategy in corrections, despite over half the prisoners being Māori. So Hokuairangi, which was going to be a Māori strategy, became the whole strategy. It is having an impact, as we've seen. There's about 850 fewer Māori in prison now. But the way things were going, if we hadn't have done that, we're going to see over 14,000 people in prison at this point of time with only 11,000 beds, and that would have been unpalatable.
Kelvin Davis's office confirmed the exact numbers of electronic monitoring and home detention with us. So since 2017, the number of people on home detention has decreased slightly to 1,600 people. The use of electronic monitoring, which can be used in a wider range of situations, has increased slightly to about 12,000 people. As well as holding the corrections portfolio, Kelvin Davis is the Minister for Children responsible for Oranga Tamariki. Since Labor came to power, the total number of young people in youth justice facilities has dropped 28%. But get this, the percentage of those in youth justice custody who are Māori has increased to more than 90%. Yeah, you heard that right, 90%.
You've been the Children's Minister since 2020. The Children's Commissioner visited Te Puna Wai or Tuhinapoa, a facility in Christchurch, in 2021. When they made a surprise follow-up visit the next year, their report found, quote, limited to no progress on their recommendations from the previous year. How is that acceptable?
Well, it isn't. And I have made it clear to Oranga Tamariki that it is not acceptable. Towards, later half part of last year, I decided to visit the Australian equivalent, so I went there early this year to look at their resources, to look at their facilities, to look at their models of care, and to see what they're doing. And there are massive lessons to be learnt. We can improve what we're doing. And one of the biggest things that I want to see, and I've been demanding it since early this year, is the greater professionalisation of the workforce. Now, I haven't been happy with the rate of change, and recent changes are now, we're starting to see progress, but it is a disappointment to me that it has taken so long for things to start to change.
3 weeks ago, video was released of young people in a youth detention facility under your watch participating in an MMA-style fight. That is the second time it's happened. Why?
Yeah, and it's totally unacceptable. There are issues around the recruitment of staff and the fact that, if I can give a comparison, Corrections has had quite a significant recruitment campaign. They've had over 5,000 people apply, but only about 500 make the grade. Now, Oranga Tamariki, I don't say only about 10% make the grade of the total applications. Oranga Tamariki, I don't think that that's the case. If they have 100 people apply, I don't think that only 10 are selected. I think that they have a lower bar, and that's not acceptable. So what has to happen is there have to be better recruitment practices, there has to be better training. I was quite annoyed to see that the training is about 2 weeks long. It's gone up to 6 weeks. I still don't think that that's acceptable. I think it should be closer to 12 weeks, 3 months of training.
Who needs training to stop children from participating in a fight club?
No, the fact of the matter is that there were staff present. That is unacceptable, and you know, those staff have been stood down. That has been dealt with. But the fact is that it shouldn't happen. The staff shouldn't be, you know, that's just unacceptable. And there needs to be better recruitment of people and there needs to be better training.
Quote, "Let me say that the fight club situation is an absolute debacle. It is a fiasco. It is a shambles. And it is an embarrassment, not only for this minister, but also for the government." Those were your words exactly 8 years ago today after the Serco Fight Club incident. Does the same description apply?
There's a big difference. At the time, the government then, the national government, were trying to privatise away their responsibilities. What I'm saying is this has happened. I accept it's happened. My responsibility is to make sure it doesn't happen again.
But those were adults. These are children. Isn't that worse?
Yeah, but
Is it worse? It's children.
Oh, it's terrible. Any violence is terrible.
That was a scathing assessment from you in opposition when it came to adults participating in an MMA-style fight. These are children under your watch.
Yeah, and the national government tried to privatise away their responsibilities. I'm saying this has happened.
Maybe privatisation would mean a higher standard of employees when it comes to Oranga Tamariki, because clearly the employees at the moment are not meeting the grade.
Yeah, well, the big thing is they did try to privatise away their responsibilities. I'm stepping up and saying this is my responsibility and we're going to fix it.
Do you agree that it's a debacle?
Oh, it's terrible. You know, and you go through a range of emotions from anger in the first instance, sadness, that these young people, they shouldn't be experiencing that, and it has happened.
Two Oranga Tamariki staff were removed from residences last month over separate allegations of inappropriate sexual behaviour. Did you miss warning signs?
And as I've said, you know, there needs to be better recruitment practices. When the first instance happened, it was dealt with, so the person was stood down, there was an investigation. Within about 8 days in a separate residence, totally unrelated, there was a similar thing. We said, that's it. We need to get in and see what is going on here. We need to make sure that it's dealt with. And what we've done is we've said to people, you need to come out. If you need to actually disclose if you're seeing that things have happened. And there have been more disclosures. The big thing is that we're dealing with it. And staff are now feeling, for the first time in years, I've been told, that they can come forward and that their concerns will be heard.
So you've set up an independent review. After the big Oranga Tamariki Advisory Board review in 2021, you were forceful in your language. Quote, "I'm going to be a bit of a bulldozer," you said. "The time for talk and the time for reviews has ended." 2 years on, you've just commissioned an independent review.
Yeah, and this is into the specifically into the youth justice residences, because I am not happy at what has been going on and the slow
rate
of change.
The time for reviews and the time for talk had ended, we thought.
Yeah, so we're not just waiting for the end of the review. There are changes that are happening as we go along, as things are coming up.
So what didn't you understand when you said that the time for reviews was over? 2 years ago.
Yeah, well, it's disappointing that we've had to go and look into this. You know, and I will admit it, that is disappointing.
Yeah, what didn't you understand then when you said that?
Well, we didn't realise what was happening in the youth justice residences. That's why Mike Bush has been appointed. No one can dispute his integrity. He's a person that is focused on the role, the job, and is getting in. And as I say, as things come to light, they are being addressed, but no doubt he'll come out with his full conclusions and we'll address those as well.
This week you announced two new youth justice facilities. You don't have a cost, you don't have a timeline, you don't have locations, you don't have a business case. Is that good policy making?
So the problem in New Zealand's youth, one of the problems in youth justice residences here in New Zealand is that there is no continuum of care. So if a young person comes in, regardless of their needs, there's a one size fits all. What we're saying is that needs to be a continuum where higher needs are looked after. So what we're talking about is, so I was in a youth justice residence yesterday, there are five units. What we're saying is that there could be a sixth unit there that is physically is designed better. There has been no investment in our youth justice residences for the last 20 years. In Australia, they sort of invest every decade or so. So the physical unit needs to be better designed, but the model of care, looking after it, it needs to be as more therapeutic, if I can use that word, to make sure that those young people with the highest of needs are looked after.
Wasn't my question, though. Is it good policy making to come out with a plan that isn't costed, doesn't have a business case, doesn't even have a location?
So that's what we're saying. There will be a business plan done.
But is it good policy making? I mean, clearly, law and order and youth crime in particular is a major concern for the public right now. We're 3 months from the election. A lot of people will look at this with a pretty cynical view and say, here is a government scrambling to look like it's acting, when actually it doesn't have any real plans, any real concrete plans for these new facilities.
Well, that's not true. I mean,
OK, how much will it cost?
Clearly there is a need. Well, that's what I'm saying. There needs to be a business plan.
Where will they be?
Well, we're saying one in Auckland, probably at Korowai Manaaki, and one in Christchurch at Te Punawai, so one with probably 20 beds and one with 10 beds. But what is clear is that there is no continuum of care, that there is no model for those young people with higher needs.
Filming a RAN raid for social media will be an aggravating factor at sentencing. What is the purpose of changing that law?
So there was a bit of a gap. Filming and posting on social media, well, we know that there is an element of notoriety, there needed to be a disincentive for filming and encouraging other people.
So it's a deterrent?
Well, what we don't want is people to be...
It's a disincentive, right?
To be advertising what they're doing and encouraging other people.
So it's a deterrence, though. That's the purpose of this law.
Yes, a deterrent factor.
So describe to me the mindset of a 15-year-old considering this deterrent. Someone who's prepared to steal a car with their mates, crash it into a store, rob the store and post that on social media. Explain to me how this will work, how the deterrence will work.
Well, so it's not just for 15-year-olds, it's for anybody.
Teenagers are the ones we're concerned about committing RAN raids, right? So explain to me how that deterrence works.
Well, there is the deterrent factor. So those young people will then, if they are, are caught posting online, there will be a consequence, and that's what the community wants to see.
I understand that, they don't care about the consequences at the moment, do they? So I want to imagine how this, changing the law, is going to change the mindset of a young person who might be considering committing a RAN raid. Explain to me their mindset
in
considering this.
Well, we know that they are impulsive, we know that they do things, but if it does impact on some people, some young people, they go, well, I need to be careful here, then we're having some impact.
You're introducing a law as a deterrence for criminals whom you say are impulsive.
Yeah, correct. This is the thing. There will be some impact on some people. It's not going to impact on everybody. If anybody committed a crime, thought, oh, there is, I may get caught or whatever, they wouldn't commit crimes. You know, so some people aren't...
So deterrence doesn't work, is what you're saying?
Well, there needs to be some consequence for doing something. And that goes with any crime.
In opposition, you called on Corrections Minister Sam Lutuwinga to resign. We've seen fighting at youth justice facilities. We've seen repeated incidents of those in youth justice facilities breaking out. We've seen recent allegations of sexual misconduct in Oranga Tamariki facilities, despite similar warnings being made in previous reports. If you thought that the previous national minister should resign, are you holding yourself to the same level of accountability?
There's a big difference as I'm stepping up and recognising and acknowledging that there are issues, be they in corrections, be they in Oranga Tamariki, and saying that we will address those issues, which is a lot different from trying to privatise away your responsibilities and not addressing them. We are addressing these issues. Both of my portfolios are very heavy portfolios. When something goes wrong, they do go quite wrong, but it's a matter of saying we know that stuff is possibly going to happen. We need to address it when it does happen, not shy away from our responsibilities in fixing things.